enlargement up and begin in a few moments. There we go. That looks better.
All right. Can you see me in there?
Oh, wait. Did you?
Oh, okay.
So it would begin in a few moments.
Says I'm live, so.
Hopefully this guy's getting my chats.
We still have a few minutes. I have a viewer. I don't know if it's you, but I have a viewer. Hello, if you're a viewer, we're still debugging the tech here.
That's a zero one.
Two.
Let's see. Oh, now I can see you.
Great. Cool. Thank you for checking that. All right, the appointed random time of 7:17 has struck, so at least start vamping for a moment to let some other folks trickle in. I appreciate you all coming out tonight. I'm glad they booked a very large room for this. Since we have a relatively small number of people, feel free to interrupt me, tell me what you want to hear, what you've got questions about, and try to keep this interactive and keep you all engaged and all that. So the purpose of this is really to sort of help bootstrap you in solving puzzles. Mystery Hunt can be intimidating for a lot of people. I invited some friends to participate with me this year, and they're all like, oh, well, as long as you don't expect me to actually contribute anything, because I'm no good at puzzles. And I'm like, you're a university professor. I'm sure you'll be fine at solving some puzzles. That's something we invite, you know, as nominally an undergraduate event. And so I wanted to sort of give you all some background, some context, some tips and tricks, walk you through a few puzzles, and sort of give you oriented so that you go in tomorrow and feel like you understand what's going on and can start making a contribution right away. Okay, so what is the Mystery Hunt? Mystery Hunt is one of the oldest and largest puzzle competitions in the world. It started in 1981, and I think other than about 1 year, 2 years in there, has been running every year since. It has a lot of people. Very soon we're going to break 2,000 participants if we haven't already. Getting an accurate count is a little bit hard, but this ranges everywhere from high school students to professors to seasoned puzzle writers to people who are this their first competition. So it's a broad range, very open event, and it's definitely a team-based event. A lot of puzzle competitions are relatively small, teams of 4 to 6 people. MIT Mystery Hunt tends to be quite a lot larger. So here's the histogram, it's a little hard to read the axes labels there, of the team registrations from last year. These are probably underrepresentations of team counts, but team sizes range from about 3 to 140 was the largest registration. The team that won was about 40 people. So you can see there's a broad range there. We had 72 teams register, and of those, 57 teams solved at least one puzzle. So we can really think of it as about 57 teams participating in the event. So it was a challenge as writers to get something that both the small teams and the large teams can have fun with, but that's definitely a goal of the Mystery Hunt, is for teams of all sizes to have fun. You can see by the large number of small teams there that that is a definite consideration. Some logistics: if your team hasn't already registered, please do that. The kickoff is noon tomorrow, and this year it's going to be in 26-100, and then that overflow to 10-250 if there is not enough space in 26-100 for everyone, because Kresge is closed for the year. And they kicked us out of Lobby 7 a couple of years ago because somebody realized that having several hundred people gathering in Lobby 7 without a permit was perhaps not the best thing. Hunt headquarters will stay open until 6 p.m. on Sunday. So it is likely that the coin will be found and the winner declared before that. But in order to let teams that are not in the running to win keep playing and keep having fun, they promise to keep taking calls and answers until 6 p.m. Sunday. So you can know that if you go to bed Saturday night and wake up Sunday, there's still something to do, even if the coin's found while you're asleep. And then wrap-up is noon on Monday, 26-100. And wrap-up is they'll be explaining how the whole thing worked, explaining the philosophy, telling funny stories that happened during the hunt, and just sort of is a chance for you then to talk to your friends on other teams, compare notes on how things went, and
it's a closing ceremony.
Yeah, closing ceremony. So there'll be an email sent out saying, "Oh, such and such team won." But if you want to like have the group experience of closing, that's noon on Monday, assuming that the coin has been found by then, which I hope for my own sake is going to happen. All right. So a little bit of more background. The booby prize for winning is getting to write the next year's hunt. So my team won 2 years ago. our prize was to write last year's hunt, and then Team Luck, I Am Your Father won last year, and they're writing this year's hunt. And it's a really great experience that you don't want to repeat again right away. So like I said, I'm on Random Fish. I'm not on Luck, I Am Your Father. So I have no inside information as to what they're doing. I know when they're starting, that last slide is all the information I have on what they're doing. And any hint, rule, or tradition, or the way it always goes that I tell you is just that, a tradition, or a way it's always gone. And they can change anything they want, and probably at least one thing I tell you will be intentionally wrong because they want to keep it fresh and interesting. So just keep that in mind. So the typical hunt goal is to find a coin hidden somewhere on campus. Hunt typically has a theme or plot, which they'll reveal tomorrow at the kickoff. They haven't, I don't think, sent out anything ahead of time, so we're in the dark as to what the theme is and what the topic is. But I'm sure it will be revealed dramatically tomorrow at noon. And then this is the sort of, the theme or plot sort of holds everything together and tries to make some sense of what's going on as the weekend progresses. And to find that coin, you have to solve puzzles. And these puzzles mostly have a word or phrase, English-ish word or phrase as an answer. Though there have in the past been puzzles that have a physical object as the answer. For example, one year there was a round where it was all physical objects where Kresge, the building Kresge, was the answer to one puzzle, and an orange rind was an answer to another. And the flag of Kyrgyzstan was the answer to another. Not the word flag of Kyrgyzstan, but the concept, the flag of Kyrgyzstan. So, it doesn't necessarily have to be a word or phrase, but that's the typical thing you'll be looking for. And if you're looking for something other than a word or phrase, you'll generally have a clue to that at some point, or suddenly realize that words aren't working here. You'll use these answers to solve a meta puzzle. And a meta puzzle is you take the answers to all the puzzles in a round, put them together, and then that forms its own puzzle. For example, last year we had 163 total puzzles, which was the most ever by two puzzles. And that was broken down into 12 rounds, and there were a total of 16 meta puzzles. And then three meta puzzles, where you took the answer to some of the meta puzzles, put them together, and then that was a puzzle. So playing with hierarchical structures is things we'll see quite a bit here.
So if you can't solve all the puzzles of round one, you can't move to round two?
Ah, that's a good question. So usually at some point they will time release the puzzles for the next round. There'll be some unlocking mechanism for each round. Sometimes it's solving all the puzzles in a round. Sometimes it's solving some portion of them, or some other mechanism. But then, in order to keep people having fun, there's usually some sort of time release. So
all the answers are released.
Well, all the puzzles are released, or new puzzles are released.
You don't need to deal with that round one. Just move on.
Usually it's structured such that the competitive teams who are going for the top spots, they need to solve everything in order to move forward. But then in order to keep the smaller teams having fun, some point after that the competitive group has already unlocked everything, then they'll say, oh look, we found some round two puzzles for you. Here they are. And then that way you can at least not be stuck on the same puzzle for a while, get some fresh ones to look at. But yeah, answers won't get released until after the hunt's over. But new puzzles will get released throughout, generally.
So Luck, I'm Your Father, they have to be constantly managing all these teams, where they're at. They're falling far behind. Oh, let's have mercy on them.
Yep. So last year, again, I don't know what Luck's doing, but last year the punt was set up in this linear depth structure. And so the further you went in the ocean, the more puzzles opened up. And so we had this formula that was constantly being adjusted of number of puzzles you solved and the time it was, set how far your submarine could go down. And we were constantly, like, once an hour, we updated the variables in that in order to try to get the most fun for everybody that we could cram in there. So we'll be making active decisions throughout about how to release puzzles in order to have people have the most fun. But that's a good question. And the way that they do that, hopefully they will mention it during kickoff, because different teams have used different formulas over the years. But usually there's something to try to keep you from being stuck on the same three puzzles the whole launch. That's boring. And like I said, they know that a large number of teams are fairly small and aren't going to get all the way to the end. So they're going to want to make sure that they see a lot of puzzles, because their goal is to have all their puzzles seen, because the person who wrote puzzle number 27 really wants everyone to see it.
Has there ever been a situation where a team had to wait for puzzles until the time release stuff?
You mean that they had solved everything they had and had to wait for
yes.
puzzles? Not since puzzle release started happening over the internet. It used to be that puzzle release was you physically had to get a packet of puzzles from somebody and hunt headquarters, which were like 7 people, and they went to sleep. And so then you would sometimes have to wait. But now that it's all automated and hunt headquarters is 40 people and up all night, then that's not something I would expect to happen this weekend. I would expect that there are going to be is going to always be puzzles for you to solve, and that no one's ever going to get stuck having solved everything and not have anything else. So, you might be stuck on 3 or 4 puzzles you have open and would really like to get some other ones, but that's a different situation than not having anything to solve. Okay, so the basic plan for the hunt is solve all the puzzles, solve the meta puzzles, go on the runaround, find the coin, and I was a little good trail off after that. So let's talk about puzzles. This is the bulk of it here. So like I said, every puzzle has an answer that is almost always a word or short phrase. And unlike a lot of the puzzles you see outside of these type of competitions, the way to go about extracting the answer is usually not explained, and figuring out what to do is the part of the puzzle. Some will give you a little bit more of a hint of how to get started than others. So answers. A lot of the answers are ones you would see in typical word games, like actual English words that everyone agrees are words. Some are more like things you would expect in crosswords, like proper names, or phrases, movie titles, that sort of thing. And then some of them are highly constrained. So SMS Palmer was a battleship that was sunk, I believe, in World War I. And Mr. Mixapitalik is a Superman villain. But I guarantee you that neither of those are in your dictionary. So more of them are going to be in the upper categories. But if you see answers like the ones at the bottom, you know that the meta puzzle had a reason for that, and we'll get to that in a little bit. But anything that sort of could be an English word or phrase with some amount of squinting is acceptable. So once you have the right, once you think you have the answer, you'll need to submit it to the headquarters. Usually, that's done by the last few years we've been using callback software. So you'll hit a button on the web page that says, I'd like to submit an answer, and you type in your answer, and then they call you back and tell you whether your answer was right or wrong, and if any other information you need to know. Typically, punctuation, spacing, capitalization don't matter for submitting answers. And if it does, that's an interesting thing. So normally, you can just treat it as a string of letters. There's also generally no penalty for incorrect answers. So if you think you have an answer, think you have a semi-educated guess, feel free to call it in. If you're being annoying and they'd like you to stop, they'll tell you that. So until they tell you you're being annoying, assume you're not being annoying. Sometimes you can narrow something down to, like, I know this is 5 letters and starts with F. That's probably not enough information to start randomly calling things in. But if you have four of those five, those letters, two or three guesses is not a bad thing at all.
Do you call in for a hint or to give up and get the answer?
So I don't know. I don't know what sort of hinting they'll be doing. Some hunts have not hinted at all. Some hunts have given hints out at particular rates. Some have given free answers out at particular rates. I think last year we did a system where we gave out the ability to ask a yes or no question about a puzzle at a particular rate that greatly accelerated toward the end. And usually there's not a lot of hinting through that mechanism. However, if you're all feeling kind of sad and you're not having fun, you should definitely like talk to the general headquarters line and tell them you're not having fun, and then hopefully they will help you with that somehow. At the very least, like come over and smile at you and like bring you a soda or something. I don't know. Don't say that I promised that they'll bring you soda. I know I am not involved this year.
Where is my headquarters?
I don't know. They're going to announce that tomorrow. So somewhere on main campus probably. But the last couple of years it's been in the Bush room, but then they've had other rooms where they've met people, so set up meetings to hand off items and things like that. Last year our team had a ton of people, and so we had a lot of interaction with teams. This year the running team has fewer people than we did, so I don't know how much interaction they're going to have, but we'll find out. Probably a lot fewer people running around in costume in the middle of the night. But that doesn't mean there won't be any people running around in costume. I really hope there will be. Okay, so puzzles can have any form. Basically anything that you could have an answer to could be a puzzle. So some of them will be standard puzzles, like with a twist. Some of them will be things that really don't look like a puzzle, and your first job is to figure out what the heck you're even supposed to do. Some of them will be identification puzzles. Some of them will be runaround, where you have to go all over campus. Some of them will be events, where everybody goes to the same place. And then there's usually a scavenger hunt of some variety during the hunt. Other than the scavenger hunt, I'll go now into each of those in detail. So standard puzzle with a twist. You'll see a lot of these because this is a good way to sort of get people into a puzzle. So for example, you have a crossword that you fill out with IPA, or a crossword where all the vowels turn out to be blood types. Or you could have a Sudoku with two solutions. Or a few years ago, there was one puzzle that was both a crossword, and then if you turn it into phone spelling, was a Sudoku. You could have something not in base 10. You could have chess puzzles that aren't actually on chess boards. They're on something else. So these ones that sort of at first glance look like something you know and love and understand, but then you have to figure out what's weird about it. Because trust me, there's not going to be just a regular Sudoku here. If so, I'd start to get very suspicious. But this gives you a good toehold on where to get started. So I'm going to go through a few puzzles now. Just to give you examples of this. Like I said at the beginning, my goal here is to make you all feel comfortable and not intimidated by Mystery Hunt. And one of the things that's often really intimidating to people is when somebody like me, who's really excited about Hunt, explains like 17 puzzles to them, and they're all like, I could never think of that. That's so crazy. You must be so much smarter than me because you were like, figured this out, and I never could. And the thing I want you to know is that, like, if I were to sit down and solve from front to back all of the puzzles that I'm going to tell you about in the next, like, 20 minutes, it would actually take me, like, 12 hours. And a lot of it would just be sitting there drooling at the page. And so I've cut out all of that. It's like the cooking show where I bring out the thing from the oven that's already baked. So the thing to remember here is that every little aha that I tell you about in here was hard won by the solvers. And just because you didn't come up with it as quickly as I could tell you about it doesn't mean that you couldn't actually make progress on the puzzle during the hunt. So please do not be intimidated here. This is just a sort of rapid-fire go-through. Okay. So the first puzzle I want to talk about is from 2014. It's called Sledgehammered. At first glance, it is a normal crossword with a nice little grid and some clues. And then you get a look at the clues, and the clues are complete garbage. And, you know, so you can take a look at that for a minute. So what to do in this case? Well, try to find some things that make slightly more sense than other things, or that might be easier. So easier could be shorter. Easier could be looks like you could throw it into Google and something might come out. Easier could be like you kind of looks like English, whatever you want to take it. So here let's look at 14 across. It kind of looks like look out, but not really. And it turns out that you can break it down into two clues, look out and a pop. And these each clue a four-letter word. And 14 across is a four-letter space in the grid. And it turns out that there are two crosswords here, not one crossword, and they've been mashed together. So you can fill out the grid two different ways. And the clues for each of them have been smashed together. Okay, so you figure that out, and you feel super clever about yourself, and then you realize you have to solve two crosswords. And this is where I like swap out the pans. So say you now you've solved two crosswords with all the things smashed together. A couple hours have passed. How do you get an answer from it? Well, we don't know for sure. There isn't text telling you what to do. One of the things you can go on, though, is we have two different crosswords on the same grid. And so there's probably something to look at there, because otherwise they'd have different grids. So we can look at where they look the same. So if you take the places where the two grids overlap and have the same letter in each of them, you can get some words out. Well, you can get some letters out, which looks like garbage. But remember that all the clues here look like garbage. And you can break them out into two words, 4 inches and schism band. And that is a hand tool. So hand as in the measurement and schism as in the tool album. And so the answer to the puzzle is hand tool, which you might notice that a sledgehammer is a hand tool and can be used to smash things together. And in this way, sometimes the titles give you just a little bit of a confirmation that you're sort of doing the right thing. They don't always, but it's sometimes useful to be like, when you're trying to figure out what the right thing is, you're like, oh, sledgehammer is a hand tool. Okay, this is probably the right answer. Let's call that in.
How did you get that first part?
Fortune being your shirts.
Yeah.
So if you filled out the two different crossword grids,
okay.
They have different letters in them. But if you lay them on top of each other,
yeah.
The sum squares have the same letter.
The sum squares?
The square has the same letter in both grids. So like the upper left square might have A in both cases. And so this is saying where do the two grids overlap? And using those overlapping letters.
But then you have the issue, like, for instance, when you did ahoy and each, how did you know that ahoy would go to puzzle A and each to B?
You don't know right away, but because that they're crossword grids, you have some, there's only going to be two ways to put them together because the crossing letters restrict it. Because you have crossing clues that will confirm a letter.
Let's say, for instance, another clue. The first one we had was look, pop out.
Yep.
And then you put the pop in crossword B, and then the lookout in A.
Yep.
Then you have another clue that's smashed together.
Yep.
How do you know that one of the clues goes to A, the other one goes to B?
Well, if there are two different across clues, you don't. You have to use the down clues, because some that are going to overlap. and go back and forth. And so that's why I was saying 2 hours later for solving this, as opposed to like, boom, it's easy, because now you have the added problem of figuring out which grid they go in.
Yeah.
And it's going to be harder than usual to feel confident in your answers, because it could go in either grid and you don't get as much confirmation right away. So, yeah. But this is, and this is one of those situations where solving with another person or a small group of people can be really nice, because one person could be tearing through the crossword clues and other people could be trying to squeeze them in and figure out where they go and trade back and forth. So definitely remember that Mystery Hunt is a team sport, and is only at the most elite levels where people are not solving everything in groups. Okay, so some lessons to take away from this one. Start with what you know. If it looks like a crossword puzzle of some kind, great, you kind of know how crossword puzzles work. Use that knowledge until you're shown that it's wrong. Start with the clues that look easier, and if you get something out that isn't quite the answer, but you can figure out a way to transform it the way you transformed other things in the puzzle, then using that same technique again is a really common thing, because it's a way for the puzzle creator to feel very clever that they were able to do the same thing twice, and it's very neat and tidy. And so you'll often see that, because people like doing things that are clever. That's why they're in the puzzle writing business, to show that they're clever, and it's fun. Okay, identification puzzles. Why is this an empty slide? Identification puzzles are a general class of puzzle where you're given a bunch of stuff, and the first thing you have to do is figure out what specifically it is. This can be a bunch of pictures, it can be a bunch of audio clips, it can be a bunch of videos, a bunch of text, like lines from poems or stories, little baggies of herbs, what came out one year. The video games hunt had one called Powder Monkey that was 20 little bags of white powder. And you had to figure out what they were. Most of them were edible. Alum tasted awful. That was the what we all learned from that one. But step one is identification. So these are sometimes referred to as ISIS puzzles, before ISIS became a bad word and was previously a nice word. For identify, sort, index, and solve. And so this is the basic way you approach one of these. So let's go through one of these. That's not Tickle Me Pink. This is Bumblebee Tune A from 2014. I forgot to finish editing my slides. Okay, so this puzzle starts with 10 videos of a person in a bee costume singing oldies songs a cappella. We'll listen to one of those in a minute. And the thing to watch out for is during each video, something that says X letters will scroll by, where X changes video to video. So, let's hear the Bumblebee Tune A. Can anybody identify that song? Somebody here must know that song.
Baby Love.
Baby Love by the Supremes. Well, okay. So, first thing you do is you identify the songs. Second thing you do is, for the songs you can't identify, you go around to your team, you play it to them and says, who knows this song? One of you must know this song. You play the oldies for the old people. You play the chiptune for the video gamers. You go around, you figure out. Somebody on your team will know at least 8 of the 10 songs, and that's probably good enough. But yeah, if you don't know it right away, just go around and bug the rest of your team, and somebody will, and then you will find a friend who knows everything. Okay, so Bumblebee Tune A. Step one, identify the obvious things, like the song, the artist. So here we know that it's Baby Love by the Supremes. And then across there it says 10 letters, but neither Baby Love nor Supreme with 10 letters, which is disconcerting. So you're not quite done yet. But you don't worry about that for now. And you just go ahead and identify as many of the things as you can. And now when I say as many of the things as you can, be careful before you like completely jump in data mine. If you don't know what you're doing, don't have like a 17 column spreadsheet with like, you know, the singer's first name and the record label they were on and their birth date and all that. Like, to start with the major things, and then if you need more things, it's easy to go pick it up from there. So get the thing that you think are going to be the most interesting information, write all that down, and then go through the rest of the puzzle. Okay, so once you've done that, you need to ask yourself things like, why is it that there are bees singing? That's got to be meaningful somehow. It would be so much easier to do it without a bee costume, unless there's a meaningful. And why is it Bumblebee Tune A and not like Bumblebee Tuna, the actual tuna product? Now, does A and B and all these trigger anything? Does any of that?
A-sides
and B-sides. Excellent. So that is the route we'll go down here. But don't worry if you don't know that. If you're like, it's okay to call your mom. It is unless your mom is on another team, which I've seen before. don't worry about that. Like, call your friends. Call your mom. It's totally cool. If they're not, as long as they're not on another team. We don't know. You didn't have to tell us who was on your team to start with. So use your resources, especially if you think they'll find it amusing.
So you're saying, call my grandpa, grandma, flip over the 45 and B-side, tell me what the song is.
Yeah, I mean, assuming Wikipedia doesn't have that information, but if you say like, but yeah, you can definitely like do that. And sometimes you're like, oh, I need the 1986 Rand McNally Road Atlas. You call somebody who's like, can you go to the library for me? Like, that's happened. So and this is the stories we tell at wrap up when it's like, you will not believe the crazy lengths here. Or like, we were certain this puzzle wanted us to call the American consulate in Tajikistan, and we did, and they didn't know what we were talking about. And we're like, maybe you should have like read the words that were on the page. Anyway, we totally never did. It was Tbilisi, and we totally didn't do that in 1999. Right. So back to the puzzle. In the days of vinyl, singles had A sides and B sides, and the B side to Baby Love was Ask Any Girl, which is 10 letters. And then if you go through and find out the B-sides to all of the songs that you just identified, you find that they're the length specified in the video. So far, so good. Okay, so that was the identify step. Now you need to sort, you put them in order. The songs were given in alphabetical order, Baby Love, Candyman, etc. If you see things in alphabetical order, that's a really good clue that they need to be in some other order. It's handy for disambiguating, because if you're missing one in the middle, you're like, the song starts somewhere between CR and DL, so it's got to be something. Like, you can narrow that down, but really it's mostly a clue that they're very specifically not in order and need to find an order. So what's a good logical way to sort songs?
Chronologically,
very good. They can be in the given order, they can be artist, length, chronological. In this case, you'll see that these songs all came out in different consecutive years from 1964 to 1973. That's also a really good sign that you're on the right track. If things are in like consecutive letters of the alphabet, consecutive years, when they could be anything, that's one of those confirmation things that authors like to throw in to give you confidence that you're on the right track. Because as you're going through here, it's totally reasonable to try a bunch of different things. And so a better constructed puzzle will give you some nudge in the right direction, or a good way to know that once you found it, that you're confident that you are going in the right direction. I can't guarantee you that all the puzzles are brilliantly constructed, but that's something to look out for as sort of a way to choose among different options. So probably not a coincidence that they're in order. Okay, so we take the B-sides, We put them in chronological order. And now the question is how to get a phrase out of that, because that's still not an answer yet. So the third step is index. You want to take the nth letter of whatever you've got. And then the question is, well, what's n? Sometimes this is clued just by they'll put like the number 3 in parentheses next to something. That might mean it's 3 letters long. That might mean to take the third letter of something longer. If they'd had just a single number go across instead of 10 letters, it just said 3, that might be a good indication that you're supposed to take the third letter of something. So oftentimes just going down the first letter is really common. That might not be clued. You just might, when in doubt, read down the first letter of whatever you've got. And if it starts to spell a word, then you can be really happy. Going down diagonally, especially if it's a rectangular set of letters, like if all the songs had the same length, then reading the first of the first one, the second of the second one, the third of the third one is pretty common. Now, in this one, there's one element of the puzzle we haven't used yet, and that's the number of bees singing. There are different numbers of bees in each video. And again, this is probably not a coincidence because the easiest thing would be to have one bee in every video or the same number of bees in every video. So when there's something that varies and it was harder for it to vary than to be the same, then that's a very suspicious thing. Similarly, if there's, or conversely, if there's something that would be easier for it to vary and it's all the same, that's really interesting. Like if all the words tend to be in a round, all the answers in a round are 9 letters long, and there are 9 of them, that's really suspicious. It would be much easier to have answers of different lengths. So start looking for these patterns of things that vary when they shouldn't or don't vary when they should. Okay, so if you take the B-sides, you put them in chronological order, and you index into them by the number of bees singing in each video, you get I get around, and you feel very clever for yourself, and you call it in, and you're told that you're wrong. Why are we wrong?
B-side.
You need the B-side. So the B-side of I get around is don't worry, baby. And that's the answer. And then you call that in, and then they say congratulations, you're correct. But you didn't lose any points for calling in the first one, so that totally is fine to get excited. But look, a common thing that teams do here is if they didn't immediately think of go to the B side, they'll have somebody call in, I get around, and then keep working on the puzzle in case something else is going on there until they get confirmation. Because often they'll fracture into two camps of half the people who believe they're done and half the people believe that there's another step left. So the thing to do in that case is try both.
But when you call in, will they say something like, you're on the right track?
No. They will generally not do that. They will just say, hello, team name. I'm sorry, but your answer of blah to puzzle blah is incorrect. And that's it. Oftentimes, the person working the phones has no idea what the correct answer even is. So they intentionally try not to betray anything over the phone. So if you're getting stuck, then you need to contact headquarters some other way and be like, we're not having fun anymore. And then hopefully they will take pity on you and help you have fun again. Yeah.
Any idea if there's going to be a hint system like you guys did last year?
They have not announced anything publicly, and I have no special knowledge.
Sure.
I knew that they reserved a room for me tonight, and that's these. And you all now know it too. So it's. But yeah, they have not made any public announcements about it. I can speculate all day long, but they haven't said anything. Okay, summarize this one. This is the work we just talked about here. So first you need to identify as many of the things as you can, and then you need to sort them by some useful sorting metric, here year. Index into them, here by the number of B's on the screen. Read down, solve. You may need to apply one of these steps again. Again, like I said in the previous puzzle, hierarchical things make puzzle solvers and writers both feel clever. And that's great. An ideal puzzle is one that it was both the writer felt clever in writing it and the solver feels clever in solving it. That is the goal of a puzzle, is for everyone involved to feel very happy with themselves. Because that's fun, because this is all for fun. Now, here's the full solution, but you can imagine that you could get pretty far in this if you had 8 out of 10, or even 7 out of 10. You wouldn't, because the indexing is based on the video, you can still know which letters you're pulling out. You may not know where the gaps are, but if you have eight, if you know there's a 10-letter phrase and you have 8 of the letters, and then you think it's probably an oldie that was like an A-side single, then that can sort of narrow your thinking space down. So don't worry about it if you can't identify everything. Another thing to do is if you're stuck on one of these, especially if somebody else has done the work and is like, screw it, I'm going to bed, here's the puzzle, I swear that all of these are correct. Do not believe them. They have made at least 2 errors. I don't know how many they've done, but they've made 2 errors. So go through and check their work. Don't believe that it's 100% correct. Because if it's 100% correct, they probably would have solved it already. So when in doubt, check your work or have someone else check your work. Yeah.
There's no penalty for wrong calling anyway and keep working.
Well, yeah, you can do that. But if you get stuck and, yeah, this is the get stuck. Because like I said, this might be like several hours of 3 people's time doing this. And if you identified 6 of the 10 of them, can't make any more progress on there, then one of the things I'll get to in a minute is you should go do something else. But when hopefully you'll hand off your work to somebody else and they can build on that. But always double check the work of the people who came before you. And don't be hesitant to say, well, if I believe that 9 out of these 10 are right, then this spells English words. Let's go with that. Because people make errors all the time, especially as it gets later into the night. Okay, so other takeaways from
this. Error in the puzzle?
There have been errors in puzzles before. Usually those get fixed midstream once somebody notices them. So somebody on your team should be monitoring their email for official announcements of errata. Usually, I don't know, Some hunts have more than others. I think last year, I think we got away with like only 2, which we felt pretty good about. But it definitely can happen. And sometimes things unintentionally happen. Like there have been puzzles that are based on subway maps and then like new stations open in the month after the puzzle was written. Or I think a few years ago, there was a Battlestar Galactica puzzle and they call out a new Cylon the Friday before Mystery Hunt, or the Sunday before Mystery Hunt, and they couldn't rewrite the puzzle in that time. So they're like, any television waves have not made it to the outer galaxy yet, and so things can happen. But until you've seen a barrage of errata emails, assume that there's not an error in the puzzle, but maybe you're the first to discover it. But assume the puzzles are good and clean and beautiful until you've found evidence otherwise, because that is a much happier way to go through the hunt. Let's see. All right, so for one of these ISIS puzzles, start by identifying the obvious things. Get as much information as you can about those, and look for patterns in that information. There's probably some sort of pattern there that you could find. Look for clues in the titles. Puzzle writers often put bad puns in the titles. Bad puns in the answers, bad puns everywhere, in part because it's funny and in part because a bad pun version of a phrase is totally not in that online dictionary you're using, which is a secondary part of it. But they like to give confirmation that you're on the right track in the title. So if there's any flavor text, any introductory text, also look at that and make sure that there's not some little like punny clue in there that you can pull out. We'll see some examples of that coming up. And look for any information you haven't used yet and try to figure out how it could come in and how you could use that. Most clean puzzles do not have any unused information, but I cannot promise that any particular puzzle is clean. I can't even promise that all the puzzles that I have written are clean in the past. And red herrings can happen in even the most well-tested puzzle. Last year, in one of the meta puzzles, if you squinted hard enough, you could get out the phrase, coin A, need I, which looked very suspicious in a mystery hunt where everyone's looking for the coin. And we test solved the heck out of that one. But we hadn't squinted in the right way when we saw that. So
what does that mean, red
A red herring, just unintentional pattern or unintentional answer looking thing. It's a phrase whose etymology has no good answer. But if you see, sometimes in puzzles, you will see if you sort them in a particularly obvious way, and then read down the first letter, it'll say like red fish or red herring or something like that. And that's to let you know that you're clever, but this isn't the thing to do. You should do something else. So if you see that phrase, it lets you know that you've gone down the wrong track, but the puzzle writer thought that was a reasonable thing for you to have tried and wants to keep you from quitting in frustration.
What the answer is, right?
Then they are evil. Because no one is going to call that in unless it's like and also we would have used that last year. we thought about it. We used every other fish pun we could think of. Okay. Another puzzle style that's common is a runaround. I'll talk about final runaround later, but it's sort of a special case of this. Runarounds is where you physically need to go somewhere to gather clues. And this may or may not be presented to you as a runaround initially, but the key is that you probably can't just sit on the couch and figure it out unless they've designed it that way. You actually have to go somewhere. So an example of that is from A Walk Around Town from 2013. This is a description of someone walking around with all of the interesting bits redacted. So let's zoom in on that. So you have to follow the directions and figure out where they go. Well, you don't know where they started, but it's a good guess that they started somewhere around MIT. And so you put in the chancellor's name, who at the time is Grimson, and then you go through, and then you have to figure out where the path would be that they'd be taking by sort of going and figuring out things you can figure out. And then eventually you probably have to go walk somewhere and figure out what building they're looking at and count up however many stories and fill that in. So you do all that, and it spells out start at old schools. And does anybody know what old schools is? So what? Good idea. Not in this case, but a good idea. That's been used before. Well, when in doubt, you throw it into Google, and you find out that old schools is a part of the University of Cambridge.
Can we go back once?
Yeah.
So you're given this, and things are redacted. It starts out with a clue, starting somewhere at MIT. Okay, fine. But MIT is kind of a big campus, but you don't know where to start. Then there's a second clue. Record the fifth letter of the chancellor's last name. So you have a second clue with an S.
Yep.
Turn right. You don't know where. Turn left.
Right.
You
have to start, like, in this particular one, you can guess the fact that that by step four, I think you're at the Star Market over on Sydney Street, and then you can figure out a set of steps that would have gotten you there from MIT campus.
I have no idea. How would you hit the Star Market if you don't have 1, 2, 3? You know the answers to
that. Well, you first have to make some guesses and then then do a logic puzzle. This was probably an hour worth of work to figure this out. Like, you also have like 30 other clues here, and you can figure out where various places have to be if you assume it's happening in Cambridge, Massachusetts.
Okay.
And because it describes a walk from MIT to Harvard, basically. And then some of it is, once you think you've got that, then you have somebody, usually a pair of people is good, physically go out, look around, figure out what the obvious path has to be, and fill it in.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so this is you need to figure out, okay, well, if I'm standing here and I'm trying to get to Star Market, the only left I can take would need to be over there, because if I take a left before that, then I can't turn right, and basically do a logic puzzle out of it.
And the start at old schools, you got that from the highlighted letters?
For all the places it says record in there, so you just, it'd be like record the sixth letter of the sign, record the fifth letter of the chancellor's name. So you go to a place, and this is a common thing is on the runarounds, is it will reference signs, ads, vending machines, other things that are physically there that are not conspicuous enough that somebody would have already put it on the internet what it says, so that you have to go around and find what's going on. So
okay.
This is, like I said, this is a good thing to send out a pair of people or three people, depending on your team size, to just go and try it and do it and solve the puzzle. If it seems to be on campus, then I definitely recommend sending a current undergrad or recent alum as one of the pair, because things change around campus all the time, and crusty alums like me will think that certain buildings are connected to other buildings when they haven't been for a while because of construction or whatever. So having some folks who know the campus, and some, you know, pairing somebody who, like, you know, is the freshman hacker who knows every which way to go, and somebody who is, like, good at puzzles but doesn't know the campus, that's actually a really good pair, because the strengths complement well. So definitely don't be shy on jumping on one of these if you, like, know the campus or know the city, but don't know puzzles super well. You can add a lot of, like, gumption to it. Okay, so once you get the old schools, it doesn't really ring any bells for most people around here, because it's a University of Cambridge thing. And then it turns out that you can recapitulate this whole endeavor on the University of Cambridge, in Cambridge, England, and do a walk around there. Now, that part of the walk, I think you could all do with Google Street View, because they didn't expect you to actually have a compatriot in Cambridge, England. But I think at least one team actually sent some folks out there. Because, you know, people play with remote teams. Like, people have friends in other places that play with them, because most things are on the internet. There's always a handful of puzzles that you need to be physically here to do. Like, some of the MIT-specific runarounds are specifically designed to not be solvable unless you have some people running around. And, like, because they will, the one year they taped letters on top of vending machines. So you had to find a particular vending machine, get on a chair, and look at what was on top of it. You just couldn't do that any other way. But they're a lot of fun if you're in the mood for that sort of thing. So for runarounds, sometimes, well, for any type of puzzle, like I've sort of hammered this in already, doing the same thing twice is a common trope. Doing it more than twice starts to get kind of grating, so twice is usually what happens. When in doubt, Google it, especially if it sounds wordsy. They assume that you have full access to the internet. They assume that you can call your friends. It is not a failing of yours if you do not know all the trivia. A modern hunt is designed that you have full access to the internet. The music identification puzzles have gotten way different than it used to be because we have Shazam now. And it used to be just figuring out that obscure song was most of the puzzle. Now that is not most of the puzzle. Now you have to figure out why it's a bee singing the song. Or maybe you have to actually identify the genre of the song, and knowing that this is like G-funk versus gangster rap is important, and something a human knows. But it's fine to totally fine to Google things, totally fine to throw into TinEye or Shazam or your favorite code cracker on the internet. That's all fair game. Let's see. And when in doubt, if there's intro text, make sure you look at it, especially if you're kind of stuck, because they often put clues in the intro text. The intro text, it's a little hard to read here, but a lot of the stuff in there is useless in this puzzle and in most puzzles. So the intro text, if it's longer than a few words, don't read it with like a biblical closeness that you might for the puzzle content, because that's we have to see what this hunt's aesthetic is. But if there's unused stuff, it's going to be in the intro text most likely. So it's useful. Don't completely ignore it, but don't treat it too much like tea leaves to read. Okay, so now one of the more interesting types of puzzles is the what type of puzzle is this? How is this even a puzzle? I don't understand. This can be a whole bunch of different types. One common one is, well, there's just a bunch of text. And it's, you stare at it, and it's not like famous text. It's not literary allusions. It's not famous poems. It's not something you're supposed to really identify. It's not something you're supposed to know. But let's zoom into this one. looking at the first paragraph, give you a moment to look at that. Anything weird there?
Bloomers.
Which one?
Bloomers.
Bloomers? Yeah, bloomers is an odd word.
Salt sex stains.
Yeah. Anything else? Maverick. Craft. There's, okay, you're catching that there's some odd word choices in there. None of it's wrong other than the salt setting stains, which I think is just an error in the writer's knowledge. But in particular, there are several words in there which share a common thread. Bloomers, Melba Toast, Maverick, and Lynch are all particularly there because they're eponyms. They're words derived from people's names. And then the Groner clue on this is that that which we call a rose by any other name would smell sweet. So because these are all people's last names, then what you need to do in this puzzle is take the first names of those people and then just take their first initials, I think.
What is the definition of an eponym?
It's an object named after a person's name. So, for example, the diesel engine is because of Rudolf Diesel. And we call them Bloomers because Amelia Bloomer made them famous.
Okay.
Now, this is one of those things that the hard part of this puzzle is staring at it long enough until you find some words that you think are interesting. You maybe Google them together. Maybe you like say them and somebody offhandedly goes like, you know, Melba, wasn't that so-and-so? Or Maverick, that was that one guy. You know, listen to what the random things people say around you are, because every once in a while that's totally the way to go for the puzzle. But, you know, this is definitely one where just staring at the thing, reading it, and trying to figure out what the heck is going on is 85% of the puzzle. And then once you figured out what the heck is going on, then you read down the first letter of people's names and you're done. There's often a concept in puzzle writing called the aha, which is the thing you have to sort of like figure out. And if there's one big aha, that tends to be the core of the puzzle, and then other things are relatively easy to do. And if it's rare, especially and for regular puzzles, for there to be two big ahas that you have that are unrelated that you have to figure out. And so here, they used one big aha and then did some standard puzzling convention of read down the first letter to fill in the rest of it. What you get out of here is says answer depart. That's something you might see is if it wouldn't be a very good puzzle if you only had like seven of these, because maybe you don't see the pattern well enough. So they doubled it, they made 14 things, so maybe it's a little bit easier to find that there's these weird words in there. Because some of them, like Angstrom, Diesel, and Crapper, are going to be a little bit easier to spot than perhaps Bloomer or Silhouette. And so they'll say answer something or something, or solution something or something, or call in something, just to let you know that you're on the right track. Especially if the answer isn't very wordy, like if it's you know, somebody's name or a really unusual word, then they might put answer and then and something. There was one, I think it was 2002, called Spare the Rod, and it was pictures of young male actors, and the answer, the phrase you got out is, yes, the answer really is penises. Because they assumed that you wouldn't necessarily just call in penises if you got that, but it has a really good set of letters. So
here the solution is, it's not just depart, the solution is answer
depart. But the thing you would call in is depart.
Oh.
Now the sort of clue phrase you get out at the end is answer depart, and so you call in depart. Sometimes you might get a more complicated clue, like, I don't know if it depart, but you might get a crossword style clue where it's like a, instead of the answer, you might just get like a short phrase that there's a one word answer to or something. So if it was like a current first lady, you could get, you or just first lady, you could get out of there. And so first lady is a one, a bad one, because you can get like three or four different words for that. But if it said current first lady, you'd call in Michelle Obama. You wouldn't call in current first lady. So those things also happen where you want a slightly longer longer puzzle to make it make more sense. Because sometimes a very short puzzle, there's 16 things you could do with it, and you don't know which one are correct. So longer ones are sometimes easier to solve. Okay, here's a particularly notable example. This is the puzzle. That's it. So the first response is, where's the puzzle? There's nothing strange in the HTML source. All you have are those six words. Now what? There's no like blank image or anything weird there. That could totally be a puzzle, but that's not what's here. So eventually, when you're working on this puzzle, you may happen to type it on a QWERTY keyboard. And notice that there's a very particular pattern on the keyboard that it forms an arrow. So it's all home row except for two letters. And it's an arrow pointing to the colon semicolon key, and they're all in caps, and the answer is colon. This was a very polarizing puzzle in that half the solvers thought this was the best puzzle they've ever seen, and half the puzzle solvers wanted to set it on fire. That may also be a sign it's a good puzzle in that it has engenders strong reactions. Yes, this was a very minimal one. And so you think, okay, what's going on there? And again, this is one where the vast majority, 98% of the puzzle, is just figuring out what the heck is going on. And then once you figure that out, boom, the answer comes pretty fast. Maybe you call in semicolon, you're told you're wrong, and then you call in colon. You know, that's also fine. And then you're like, oh, they're uppercase, okay. So this was a particularly noteworthy example. Okay, so some things from these. Look for whatever patterns you can find. Notice any words or other items that look out of place or seem forced. Like spilling something wine on your bloomers is hard. Why would you do that? If you don't have much to go on, consider what you do have. Now, if there aren't any words present, well, there's got to do something to get from wherever you got to words, and that sort of thing. And some way, times the right way forward just really isn't obvious. And here you have, you show it to other people on your teams. Like, does this mean anything to you? So what do you see? This is one of those places to use the group effort. If you stare at it for a long time, don't figure anything out. Tap out, give it to somebody else, go do something else. Maybe you let it percolate in your brain, and maybe you'll have a great idea. And one thing I mentioned on the last one is there was nothing in the HTML source for JFK Shags a Slad Slim Lass. So, but it's totally reasonable to look in the HTML source of a puzzle. It's totally reasonable to take that GIF and look at whether there are animation frames that aren't playing or what the palette's set to look at MP3 tags, PostScript code, ID3 tags. If it's media of any sort, look at the metadata if you don't know what else to do. Now, if there's like six pictures of things you can identify, that's probably what the puzzle is. The puzzle probably isn't weird like GIF encoding things, but it's totally reasonable for there to be relatively esoteric computer tech stuff on a few of the puzzles. And if you're not making progress in the obvious things, start looking at those or grab somebody down the hall who would find that amusing and hand the puzzle off to them. I believe last year we had a puzzle that played off the word image and used both hard drive like images and picture images, and you could have like JPEGs that if you read them another way, or no, it was TIFFs, if you read them another way, were like hard drive images. And for some people, this was the best puzzle, and everyone else was just went and worked on a crossword. And it's great. And there's a multiplicity of types of puzzles here. You are not going to like every puzzle in the hunt. You're not going to be able to solve every puzzle in the hunt personally. That's cool. Find the ones you do like and can solve. Okay. So many Mystery Hunt puzzles don't fit into types. As I was saying about the aha, sometimes you just got to figure out what's going on, and that's the whole puzzle. Some require recognizing things. There was a My Drunk Kitchen puzzle, Gashly Crumb Tiny's puzzle. Last year there was a Dresden Kodak puzzle. And at some point you have to recognize what it is. And it can take a long time of like, what the heck is going on? But then somebody walks by and goes, hell, that's My Drunk Kitchen, and walks off. And then you're like, ah, you solved the whole thing. So, you know, again, show it to your teammates, talk about it, see if somebody else has that sort of entering aha. Some puzzles aren't what they seem. Like I was saying about some of the tech puzzles are often hidden. There was a text adventure that turned out to be Feynman diagrams. One of the ones I thought is particularly cute was the ones where they are related, like the Sephiroth from Final Fantasy and the Kabbalistic Sephiroth was a puzzle about both of them, or ski resorts and ski trees. Like those are, again, the feeling very clever on both ends when you figure that out. So it shouldn't be the case that you do the first half of the puzzle and are super happy about it, and then you're completely confused and somebody else has to do the second half as far as topics go. Hopefully that doesn't happen, but it may be that you're not able to make any progress until you notice that it's not what it seems to be. This sort of hidden layers thing is pretty common. Don't feel bummed if that's what happens. Okay, event puzzles. Event puzzles are a particular interesting type of puzzle this is one I'm going to be shakier on what's going on in them, because event puzzles have been changing a bunch over the years. Back when rounds were handed out on paper or released at particular times, then getting everybody together at one time to do a puzzle could just take part in a round like any other puzzle. But that's not really possible now that it's sort of the hunt's a continuous process. We still have event puzzles because people still want to see their friends and go interact with other people and get the heck out of their classroom for a while. So the event puzzles usually involve interaction between teams. Often they involve cooperation between teams. Sometimes you're cooperating with another team, like representatives from two teams competing as representatives from two other teams. So you form these momentary alliances and cooperations because this is the part of the social aspect of hunt, of getting to know people from other teams. Sometimes they're just purely for fun, participate, and everybody who hangs out like gets the answer. Sometimes they require mild solving, and you need to write down the information you've got, go back in with your teammates, solve it. Sometimes they're in the middle. Try not to leave the event without an answer. And if you are leaving the event without an answer, maybe check in with the headquarters people there and see if they think that's a good idea. Because sometimes they'll be like, yeah, you've got what you need, go take it back to your team and solve it. And other times they'll be like, well, you're probably pretty screwed if you leave right now. So don't leave without getting that sort of okay for them. The event schedule is usually announced at the start of hunt. And then the effect of events on the hunt is generally talked about then as well. Whether they will give you answers that are part of the rounds. They've previously been used to give hints or free answers. They've also been used to as another round. Like, if you want to win the mystery hunt, you also have to do all the events. And so they were just their own thing. These have all been tried. Like I said, I'm being a little fuzzy because it could be anything there. Last year, we tended to be having collaborative style events where groups of people from different teams would work together and competing against folks from other groups from other teams. They had one where some people had to like write down a description of these wonky little objects made out of like cups and pins and things, and then their teammate would have to build it based on the description they had written. And so communication challenge there. We had one in the pool where there were important things on the bottom of the pool, and one person had to dive down and get them off the bottom of the pool. And then the other teammate was standing on the edge of the pool, and they had a remote control boat with a basket on the top. So they had, the diver had to put the things in the boat, and then they had to be driven back to shore. So there was a little bit like a collaborative aspect within the team, not across the team. And then my personal favorite of the events was Steam Team. There's a game, Space Team, where you're yelling out technobabble. And here we had to upgrade the plankton coils. And so this is two teams working together and trying to finish before other pairs of teams finish. So that's a thing that goes there. That's basically what I would say about events. All right, so wrapping up the puzzle section, some general extraction tips. Read the first letters of things. Look for anything in the puzzle you haven't used yet or anything that doesn't need to be there. Those are suspicious. Look for anything that could encode an answer, that could encode letters, because most of the time you're trying to get out letters. If you've got numbers, you're going to need to turn them into letters. If you've got pictures, you're going to need to turn them into letters. The numbers 1 through 26, those map A, B, C, D up to Z very quickly. ASCII, I think, starts at 65 and up. We'll get you some letters. Semaphore angles, if you see clock hands or anything else that's an angle, look for semaphore. Morse code, resistor codes. Look at all of these things as ways to get turn one type of information into another type of information. Sometimes it's clued. If they talk about being blind or stumbling in the dark or feeling around, look and see if it's Braille. If you see tapping or dots or dashes or, you know, they reference walking up Telegraph Avenue or something like that, think about Morse code. Okay, now one of the common things that will happen is that you will get stuck on a puzzle. This is totally normal. Do not feel bad about yourself. There are some lists online of have you tried? The Acme one from several years ago on the main hunt site is actually pretty good for the, like, have you thought about Braille? Have you thought about Morse code? Is it a runaround? And a lot of times you go like, no, no, no. Well, let me check that it's not a square, you know. Let me check that these numbers aren't all special. Get some fresh eyes, you know. Grab your friend, say, hey, can you just take a look at this? Does this mean anything to you? You want to work on this with me? Like, that is huge. It's totally fine to call a friend from elsewhere if you want, as long as they're not on another team. And my biggest advice is just walk away. Go do something else. You can work on a different puzzle. Take a shower. Eat a sandwich. Take a nap. Just walk around the block. Get a soda. Like, all of those things are amazing. Like, the tendency of people I've seen at hunts to just sit down and then, like, stare at one piece of paper unmoving for 4 hours, feeling increasingly worse about themselves as a human being is really large. If you catch yourself doing that, just take a break. This is a marathon. It's going on until Sunday at 6 p.m. You can spare 20 minutes. You just can. Some glucose and some, you know, rest, it'll help. And if you're and not all puzzles are good. Some puzzles reference something you don't know. Some puzzles involve topics you've never heard of. Some puzzles are just poorly designed. Even some of the puzzles that I was an editor on last year, in hindsight, I regret some of the choices that were made, and we could have made them more fun for more people. So if you're not having fun, go work on another puzzle. There is no shame in that. If you're worried that you're not going to make a contribution at all in the hunt, then sitting there feeling worse about yourself is really not going to help that. So just go work on something else. Have fun. This is, in fact, for fun. If you are not on a team that is like, we are going to win, this year is the year, then you're not under pressure, just have fun. And even then, you'll be better if you're rested. That's one of the things I noticed last year from test solving. A lot of puzzles were way easier when I was test solving them because we just show up in the middle of the day, well rested, well fed, relaxed, and be like, oh, I just solved that puzzle, done. And then Hunt, we're like, oh my God, I gotta solve this puzzle real quick and everything's going on. And they're like, relax, it's cool. So take a step back, have fun. All right, meta puzzles. Okay, a meta puzzle is a puzzle that incorporates the answers from other puzzles into itself. It is often used as a capstone to the round. Puzzles don't have to come out in rounds, but they often are sort of encapsulated in rounds, and the meta puzzle is the cap on that. And there could be super metas or meta metas that take advantage of these or not. The meta puzzle answers generally are thematic to the hunt. For example, the 2013 bank heist hunt, each round had a character, and you needed to, the meta puzzle answer was a way to convince them to join your bank heist. So for Indiana Jones, he needed a partnership with BOA, because he doesn't like snakes and Bank of America. They're not good puns, but they're puns, often. Because again, that's so hard to guess. So 2012, each round had a musical critic. And the way to offend them and into the Woodstock was that Rapunzel had a fro. So these are the types of meta answers. They tend to be a little bit more strange and connecting to the overall theme of the hunt, as opposed to the individual round puzzles, which may or may not have much to do with the overall theme. There are two main types of meta puzzles. They're pure metas, where all you need are the answers, or maybe answers and titles of puzzles. And then there's shell metas, where you have some puzzly information that you need to plug the answers into. So I'll give an example of these. So from last year, the graveyard meta is an example of a pure meta. There was no additional information. You just had the meta page that said, when you know the thing, give us a call. So does anybody notice anything about the titles? Ring any bells for anyone?
Goosebumps.
Yes. They're one word off the titles of the first seven Goosebumps books. And so you go ahead and you reorder them in that order. I think it was Welcome to Dead House, Stay Out of the Basement, Monster Blood, Say Cheese and Die, The Curse of the Mummy's Tomb, Let's Get Invisible, and Night of the Living Dead were the original ones. So if you play around with the swapped out words, it doesn't really spell anything. Those are just thematically ocean-y things. Okay, so it's about Goosebumps, and you've been talking about this for a while, and it gets really late at night. What do you say now? Anybody? You're starting to get a little bit punchy and talking about Goosebumps, your favorite books. Anybody? Okay, well, so there's this meme, Ermagerd Gershberms, my favorite books. So this is a thing going on the internet, and we didn't come up with it. But eventually, if you talk about this long enough, someone on your team is going to go, Ermagerd, Gershberms, and then like walk on and get their soda or whatever. And then you realize that that is the key to everything. And that in the answers, there's one syllable that has an er. And so it is Merkernerker Schermernster, or mechanical sea monster, was the answer to this one.
Oh my God.
This was, again, one of those polarizing ones. We got screamed at a little bit in the like, it wasn't, it's like we, at 6 p.m. we didn't get it, but 3 a.m. it all made sense. And like, well, that's when we wrote it, so. But this is a classic example of a pure meta where just the titles and the words, sometimes only the words in the answers matter. Here's an example. In 2014, the clubs meta, there were different suit, three of the suits of cards were the metas there. They don't seem to be related in meaning. Can we find any patterns in the words and letters?
Yeah, the last three letters of some of these are the first, like abysmal, practice, yeah. Sandwich, a bod, inside.
Exactly, beginning and ending trigrams overlap. And so this is one where, as you're getting the words to the round, you may not notice it right away, but once you have like three quarters of the words, you can start seeing these patterns, where you can form this chain with beginning and ending trigrams. Okay, now how do we get the answer out of that? It does not have to do with codons. But that's a thing you could totally check in Hunt, but it turns out not to. In this case, it's the letters in the center of the threes. But now you know the letters and you put them in that order. And this is one of several reasonable things you could try. This is the one that you try that works. So, again, I am accelerating the timeline of figuring things out. It would be totally reasonable to spend 15 minutes staring at this, 20 minutes staring at this.
So a meta is hotter than the base puzzles?
They are not necessarily harder per se. They have the... They tend to not have a lot of excess stuff. Like here, you just have the words to play with. You don't have any other things going on to give you structure. And the other thing about them, the thing that tends to make them difficult, is that you don't solve all the puzzles in your round all at once. So in this this example here, there are how many? 2, 4, 6, 8 things. You don't solve all 8 puzzles at once. Answers are going to trickle in one by one by one. And at some point, you need to start looking at them and figuring it out. And so the trick is usually solving it before you have all the answers. Because usually solving a meta will open up some more puzzles. And if you don't want to be stuck on that puzzle anymore, if you can just jump across it, then that's great. So that's one of the things that tends to make them harder is that you can't necessarily just get all of the information. I've basically said all that. This is speed up a little bit, but the caucus race meta from 2014 is a good example of a shell meta, where you have the answers from the round and you have something else that they've given you, some structure to put it in. So you've got intro text, in this case, you have all these birds giving you questions in pairs, giving you puzzles in pairs. They have a yes puzzle and a no puzzle. And then you have boxes at the bottom that you're going to fill something in, probably words. You try to put the answers in there, and they don't fit. So that's the first thing you're going to try, is just stick the answers in. That doesn't fit. Okay, so what do you do? You have these yeses and nos. So each bird there wants to vote yes and no. We have a plus column and a minus column. And so let's take a look at the answer words that we got from this. And so they open the boxes, the yeses and the nos. Let's take a look at those for a minute. The interesting thing about this one is that it's birds. And then in the Alice in Wonderland, the caucus race was a race of birds. The fun thing here is that you actually have to take a synonym or an antonym for each answer that's a bird. So echo is parrot, millstone albatross, and gulf swallow, and so on. And so this is the feeling clever part of the puzzle, so that each answer has synonym or antonym that is a bird.
Yeah, I like this one.
Yeah, this was a pretty good one. I enjoyed solving this one. Because it's 2014 had some really nice metas. And then you fill in those these birds do fit in the spaces that you've got there. And then you look at the called out letters, and that spells allergic to down, which is something that was, which is a thematic thing. Like I said, you almost never need all the puzzle answers to solve a meta puzzle. Usually trying to solve it with 2/3 to 3/4. Sometimes you get all the answers, and that's great. And once you have a few answers, trying to look for patterns, try to figure out what you can see there, determine the mechanism. Sometimes it's useful to figure out, okay, I'm pretty sure we're looking for things that have synonyms or antonyms that could be words that are birds, because maybe you tell that to somebody working on a puzzle in that round, and that gives them the idea of what they need to solve it. Sometimes you, like I said, if you get a string like this in a bird-related puzzle, and you're looking for weakness of a beast, you might be able to sort of zen out on it and get the allergic to down thing. And this is where writing it up on a whiteboard or chalkboard and having everybody stare at it as they walk by for a few seconds, because somebody might be like, that looks like whatever. There's always, the good stories are always, you've been staring at something for a while, and somebody walks in and is like, oh, those are all anagrams of South American capitals if you change one letter. You're like, how did you notice that? So a lot of this is just waiting for that inspiration to strike, so make sure you give it plenty of opportunities for that. Okay, back solving. Once you've solved the meta or figured out its mechanism, sometimes that puts strong constraints on what the answers for the other puzzles in that round have to be. And so it's possible to back solve the answers from those constraints alone. For example, in the club's meta, if you didn't have abysmal, but you knew that something had to start with ABY and end in MAL, there's not very many words that do that. And it's totally legitimate to call in answers that you've derived this way. That is a thing that all of the top teams do. It is not cheating. It's part of the game. And so sometimes it doesn't give you enough to really get too far. But like I said, if you tell somebody, like, I think the answer to this, it needs to start with ABY, or it's 9 letters and starts with A, might really be able to narrow them down and give them some additional clues they need to solve some things. That is like I said, a totally legitimate tactic. And remember that there are no penalties for wrong guesses, so if you've narrowed it down to 3 different words in English that have this pattern, just call them in one after the other. If you've narrowed it down to 50, you might want to wait a little bit on that. Maybe pick the most word gamiest word out of it or something, the one you like the best, but after that, just wait till you've narrowed it down to fewer. Okay, so solve the puzzles, you solve the meta puzzles. Now we go on the runaround and find the coin. So runarounds, I talked about a little bit earlier, it's a general class of puzzle where you have to physically go somewhere and go from place to place. The final runaround is the end game of the mystery hunt. Sometimes it involves quite a lot of following a riddle trail around the campus and figuring out where to go next. Sometimes it involves being guided from set piece to set piece by a guide. Both are valid ways of doing the end game. Just depends on how they've set it up. So last year, there were 5 end game challenges that teams needed to do. For example, this shows a word search that is all one word search, and then we coded 90 some odd of the answers to the hunt in there, and they had to find those. Once they'd proven that they knew all the answers to the hunt, then there were some letters left over, and that spelled out a phrase. There was a human pictionary. Half the team was on the floor of Lobby 7, half the team was on the 3rd floor. And then people on the floor would make a picture, and the people up top would have to know what to say what it was. So these were intended to be like whole team games, as opposed to other times it might be like two or three people trying to solve some riddles or what have you.
What time does this note typically happen? Like last year?
I think Death Mayhem, this wasn't the first thing. This was like 3 a.m. Sunday. The two teams that first solved the Atlantis meta was at like midnight Sunday, and then we got on runaround by I think about 2 a.m. Sunday, and the final one, they finished at 5 a.m.
Oh.
We had four teams going through final runaround at the same time, which is two more than we planned on. but it was and so it was extremely close last year between the top few teams. Some years it's very close, some years it's not.
So typically, late Sunday night or early, late Saturday night, early Sunday morning is when the winner.
Yeah, if I were placing wagers, I would say that it would be sometime when it's dark on Sunday, in the morning, would be when I would bet. The shortest hunt in the last 10 years has been 36 hours. The longest has been 63. I'm guessing it's going to be 40. Like I think last year was 41 hours. So I'm guessing early 40s hours.
63 is like what, Monday?
Yeah, that one was long.
Free answers all around.
Yes. Yes, there were a lot of free answers by the end of that one. Yeah, so it's probably not going to be that. The last time Luck wrote, I think, which is 2010, I think they had a 40-something hour hunt. And they say that they're going to keep HQ open until Sunday at 6 p.m., which means they believe that it will be done well before that. They may be right, they may be wrong, but they believe that that most teams will finished by then, or not? Most teams that were competing to win will have been well done by then. That's what.
So they won. How many times has Luck won? Last year they won. In 2010 they won.
In 2009 they won, and last year they won. So this is their second time riding.
How many teams are usually in competition to actually win?
Good question. Do I have a? I wrote that down somewhere, but not on the slide where it would have been useful. Last year, 11 teams finished. One of those finished like 6 p.m. on Sunday. There were between 3 and 5, depending on how you count, really in the running teams to win. So I would say that 3 to 5 teams is a reasonable guess for have a strong chance of winning. Because that's some teams that might have a chance if they really tried have not worked on recruiting a lot of people so that they don't.
Well, and then there are the teams that start drinking.
And then there are teams that I have told that one of the more famous start drinking teams has gone back on that oath. But yeah, so it's not all teams are in it to win it. And so, but I'd say there's probably 3 to 5 who have a reasonable chance of winning it.
Does this final runaround stop like once someone has won, or are people still allowed to do it?
Since the shift to having HQ open after the coin is found, they tend to let other people go on the runaround because it's fun. So like I said, last year we had 11 teams do the runaround, which is the most that have ever done it. And then I think previous year had like 5 or 6 teams do it.
At the same time, right?
Yeah, we had I think at peak 5 teams going at once, one at the beginning, one at the end of it. But yeah, we did not recommend to Luck that they have a multi-hour runaround with 5 teams going on at once. That maybe they want to adjust their strategy a little bit on that because that went a little too far, but we'll see what they ended up doing, because this is one of the least test-solved parts of Hunt, because it's really hard to have the conditions of an end game be figured out. So the goal of the whole mystery hunt, and in the particular the runaround, is to find the coin. Now, originally the coin was an actual coin. It was an Indian head penny. And you had to actually figure out what part of campus it was in, and there was a riddle trail that like had you going up and down stairs, around corners, and looking under ceiling tiles, and like physically locating it. Other years, like the last few years, once you've gotten to the last sort of set piece location and done whatever deed was asked of you then the coin was given to you because you rescued it from the bottom. I think last year we had a lodestone that you had to find at the bottom of the ocean. And then the definition of coin has become relatively loose. And so it may be the space one a few years ago, it was a continuously operating inversion node. It was just some MacGuffin you had to find. That's the overall goal, is to find the coin, whatever that is this year. To wrap up, some tips if you're on a smaller team. Smaller teams don't tend to finish. Newer teams don't tend to finish. Here's where I actually wrote it down. Last year, 11 teams finished. They were all experienced teams. So if you're a brand new team, full of relatively inexperienced people, don't set your feelings of how like competent you are as individuals on finishing the whole hunt. Pick another goal that's more achievable. And then if you exceed that, then you can feel really good about yourselves. For example, try to solve, like say, oh, we're going to at least solve a meta, or we're going to at least solve two metas this year. And I think last year, I said 57 teams solved at least one puzzle. Of those, 39 solved one meta, and 26 solved the workshop meta, which was the first three rounds. I don't know what luck's going to do, but last 2 years, we totally copied this off Alice Shrugged. The first three rounds have been self-contained three rounds before launching into the next rounds in order to give a sense of completion of getting to do something. Like we even had last year, once you solved the workshop meta, you had to run around campus and get a bunch of things in order to finish that one off, to try to give primarily smaller teams a sense of having completed a noticeable chunk of the thing. And we suggested to Luck they do something like that because it was well received. We'll see what they actually do. So set your sights relative to your team's experience level. And you can have your own internal goal of be like, okay, I want to contribute to a bunch of puzzles, or I want to see a bunch of different puzzles. You know, figure out what you need to do in order to feel happy about yourself. Don't just aim for the top. And if you're not having fun as a team, tell headquarters that. They might throw you a bone. They might come by and say hi and like chat with you about things. If they hear that from several teams, you might suddenly all get a bunch of new puzzles to solve. Don't be whiny at them, but definitely if you're not having fun, say so. That's because this is for fun. And tips for newer hunters, regardless of your team size, it's okay to be stuck for a little while. Like all of the ahas I showed you up here, it's totally fine to just sit and stare at it for like half an hour before like you have any idea what's going on, or longer. That's fine. But if you're starting to not have fun, if you just like, I'm staring at this and nothing's happening, go do a different puzzle. Or go take a walk. Work with your friends. Small groups tend to be pretty effective here. 2, 3, 4 people looking at a puzzle is more fun and more effective than one person in most cases. Don't feel shy in sharing your ideas, especially if you're working with more experienced hunters. You may feel that like, they know what's going on. I don't know what's going on. I'm just going to keep my mouth shut. I think there's this pattern here, but it's probably bullshit. Just say it. Say it out loud. Make sure somebody's actually heard you, because sometimes people will talk and some people aren't even listening. Because you don't have to be right all the time. Because if you're right like once and it really like solves the thing, then you're going to be happy and they're going to be happy and it's going to be great. So actually say your ideas, especially if you're the kind of person who doesn't feel totally comfortable jumping in, saying your ideas all out loud, make an effort to do so. It will overall pay off. And one of the things to be looking for are patterns, but a really important thing is to not let confirmation bias take over. There's a lot of patterns in English language. There's a lot of, it's like all of these things have E's. It's like, yes. There's a lot of SH's in here. Yes, there are. And so it's really easy to get fixated on something and look for it and go like, well, the exception we found, that we probably got that one wrong. That may be the case, but one of the useful things to do is go through and say, okay, if really the pattern is there aren't any, like, there aren't any E's, is there one here that has to have an E to break my pattern? Look for the things that break your pattern rather than the things that completely confirm your pattern. Once, because it's really easy to find, if you have 8 answers in a round, any 3 of them you can find a pattern in. But it's really hard finding, say, all 8 answers in the meta. So, make sure to look for those and not just get fixated on the partial patterns you do find.
I forget what confirmation bias means.
Oh, it's the once you see something, then you look for confirmatory evidence and don't look for disconfirmatory evidence. So all the new data you find confirms your hypothesis because you didn't even look at all the other data. So it's important to look at all the data we've got there.
And when you sign up, do they give you a classroom?
They already did that.
Oh, so it's too late?
It's probably too late to get a classroom, but definitely talk to them. Maybe they have spares. But
it's not too late to sign up.
It's not too late to sign up, no.
All right, so you don't need a classroom. You could do it out in the, I don't know.
Yeah, you could do it from the comfort of your own home or some nook in the student center or wherever is comfortable for you. Most of it's online. As long as you have access to campus, then you'll be able to play the whole thing.
And they'll give you the Wi-Fi password.
I think it's a guest network. All right, and finally to wrap up, make sure to have fun. That's my presentation. I'm quite happy to stick around for a little bit longer, take questions either in general or individually.
And can you send the PowerPoint slide?
Yeah, I can. There, I will share those. It'll be just a minute here to turn them on, and happy to do that.
So one quick question.
Yeah.
I think Luck is going to try to beat your record for most puzzles to a single meta.
I'd be surprised. We sort of picked that one to stand the test of time. So it was like 56 or something.
Yes, I managed to solve the entire thing.
Nice.